So we're very, very proud to be a part of this celebration that for the first time in a very comprehensive way brings all of those people together in one place at one party to be honored for liberating women in sport.
The idea was to build the strongest athletic department possible, serving all the students who wanted to take advantage of it.
Barnard began competing in sports back in the early 1900s, although shortly after they started developing some sports teams, they looked to pretty much keep competition within the college, and interclass competition was the big thing. The Greek Games were formed, which were opportunities for women to compete in sports and dance and tumbling and chorus and poetry. They were wonderful celebrations that lasted until about 1968.
Eventually, those games gave way to the play days, the first competitions between schools. And in 1975, in response to strong student interest, physical education chair Marion Phillips established the framework for an intercollegiate athletic program and became its first athletic director.
I was there from 75 to 81, and in 1975, a pilot program was instituted at Barnard, and it was a very bare-bones type operation. The teams had to share uniforms. They shared shorts and shirts. They shared warm-up suits. So regardless of which sport you were participating in, the bathing suits notwithstanding, everybody had to share those particular uniforms. All the way from Washington,
her breadwinner begs off the bathroom floor. Barnard student competitors started to make themselves known in the record books. Students like All-Ivy All-American and current Ivy diving record holder Tina Stack, fencing All-Americans Ella Christo Nagy, Tracy Burton, and Lisa Piazza, cross-country All-American Ilanka Wills, All-Ivy volleyball star Zenta Batarags, tennis players Lisa Shapiro and Philippa Feldman.
I was always obsessed with junk food, so a lot of the girls used to bring me food in the middle of my matches, and I can remember being down and having to go to a third set, and someone brought me, I think it was either snowballs or devil dogs, and I won the match, and people have never let me forget that.
Archers Nancy Ketchum and Petra Hubbard, and basketball players like Nora Beck. When Columbia went co-ed in 1983, it had to find a way to provide a sports program for their women undergrads.
It was evident in the early 80s that Columbia College was going to become co-educational, that we would then have to have a women's intercollegiate athletic program. But we couldn't have one for the first few years because the number of women enrolling in the college were not sufficient enough to field the teams that we wanted.
Could Columbia and Barnard work together to benefit both their programs, attract more student athletes, share facilities, and thrive? The answer was yes, by creating the Barnard-Columbia Athletic Consortium.
I'm not sure Columbia knew what to do with women. They had been dealing strictly with the men's program. Not that they weren't interested, but I think it was certainly to their benefit to cooperate or combine with Barnard and inherit Barnard's nine-sport program right off the bat, where Columbia women would be able to compete in all of those sports.
We enjoyed the experience of having a women's athletic program. It just made things a lot more fun. Put me in cold.
I'm ready to play today. It's been 20 years since the consortium was formed. Sports have clearly come into their own, and for men and women at Barnard and Columbia today, they've become a necessary, integral, and essential part of university life.
The transition from Barnard to Columbia was a nerve-wracking time, I think, for everybody. Marge Tversky and Al Paul were working together with the presidents of both Columbia and Barnard to try and ensure that Barnard and the Barnard name wasn't lost in the transition. Oh, put me in cold. I'm ready to play today.
Under Coach Nancy Califas, basketball's Ellen Bossert helped lead the 85-86 Lions to win the New York State Championships. Ula Lisniak and Charlene Schussler eventually went on to play professionally in Europe.
When I was on the court, I heard my mother's whistle. That's the only thing I used to hear when I was out on the court. If my mother wasn't there, my father didn't come before the game, but they came a few minutes after the game started. She put her fingers in her mouth, let out a real loud whistle, and I just knew she was there. It was always very comforting.
Lisa Ledwith, a two-time All-Ivy selection, and Amy Creer starred for the early volleyball teams. Later years saw three-time All-Ivy Kathy Levold. In track and field, Coach Kate Moore produced Columbia's first two heptagonal champions in Carrie Daly and Heather Rutta.
I'll never forget Kate Moore, who was our illustrious track and field coach, the first one that we had hired. And she was a character in her own right. She used to come up with all kinds of creative ways to get the women to train harder. If anybody was late to practice, she would make them run with an 11 or 12 pound bowling ball.
In tennis, Happy Ho became the school's first nationally ranked woman. No student athlete achieved more than swimmer Christina Teuscher. Undefeated in 4 years of undergraduate swimming, winner of Olympic gold and recipient of the Honda Broderick Cup, swimmers and divers include Anna Martins, who set three school records in her very first meet and dominated for 4 years under the coaching of Jeff Ward. Others include Denisha Ambrun, Lucy Ecclestone, Teresa Herman, and Grace Coyle. After midnight, we don't
shake your tambourine. After midnight. New York City is the dancing capital in the U.S. So obviously, if somebody want to set goals to be Olympic members, the best place is to come to New York.
Fencing, led by two-time NCAA champion and four-time All-American Katie Bilodeau, won its first Ivy women's title in 1989. Followed quickly by four NCAA regional crowns, four Ivy League women's titles, and four regional titles.
For us, Katie was the first one. She was the one who really sort of set the level, and it was very high for women's fencing. It was such a wonderful thing to go into a competition and know that you had this tremendous talent.
The 90s produced an NCAA champion, Zoo Moy, three IFA champions, 13 All-Americans, and the 1993 U.S. Fencer of the Year, Anne Marsh. Soccer's stars included Carrie Martin, Tosh Ford, and a superb goalkeeper, the late Allie Ahern. Lacrosse produced three-time All-Ivy Leaguer Sarah Brubaker and Antoinette Allen.
I remember the young lady coming down the field, and she had bypassed all of our defense. I swung to check her, and I missed. And so she ran right past me. And in an effort to sort of catch up to her, the only thing I could do was run as fast as I could and try and clip her, but clip her in a very discreet way so that I wouldn't get a yellow card or a red card from the ref. And so I ran so fiercely to the goalie to stop her from making a goal that we sort of got entangled and both ended up in the goal cage with the goalie. And of course a foul was called because I was in the wrong and she went for a foul shot, but she missed. So in the end, it ended up being completely worth it.
Archery produced five straight years of All-Americans and a second place in the nation for the team in 2000. Crew, begun in the mid-80s under Ed Hewitt, has developed into a strong contender for postseason competition. Softball, going into only its fifth year at Columbia, has already fielded one of the Ivy's best players ever, pitcher Allison Buehler.
First day at practice at Columbia University, and Coach Christine Vo assigned me lucky number 13, and Anne-Marie Ebner stepped up to the plate and hit the ball right back at me through the screen, and I had the largest black and blue bruise on my leg, on my hip. And then I went and changed my number to number 7.
Unfortunately, my distinction is I was hit by record number of pitch, I think 12 times this season, which has never happened before and I doubt will ever happen again, so I'm proud to say that. Got hit a lot.
Basketball registered its first victory ever in Division I over powerhouse Harvard,
and swept series from both Princeton and Brown. Cross country has won two straight Ivy League heptagonal titles and placed twice in the NCAA championships. Field hockey won the ECAC championship in its first and only postseason competition, with Florencia Battiana and Nikki Campbell winning first team All-Ivy.
Being a part of the field hockey team at its inception was totally amazing experience and probably the best I had in college. And I really look forward to seeing it in another 20 years. And who knows, maybe I'll have a daughter one day and she'll play on the team, or one of my teammates will, but it will have all been worth it if that.
This year, Columbia added golf, its 15th intercollegiate women's sports team. And what does the future hold? In the 20 years of the Columbia-Barnard Athletic Consortium, more than 200 student-athletes wearing the light blue and white have been selected as All-Ivy League. Without a doubt, the best is definitely yet to come.
With my team that would sort of make Marge a little nuts was that I would take them out for ice cream after our meets, our away meets. We would always find the ice cream parlor, and we would finish up before we got into the van to come home. We would have ice cream, and I would charge it to Margie. I would say it's on Margie, but Margie would say, Sharon, we don't have a budget line for ice cream. You really can't buy them ice cream on Barnard. But we always kind of snuck it in, and she never really didn't pay for it, but that was the thing on Marge. Thanks, Marge.